everyone, and welcome to another one of our Legends podcast here on Eurosport. And today I am joined again by my good friend and the Masters champion of 1998, Alex Kurecha. Alex, I'm going to give you a chance to talk just now because we also have the eight-time Grand Slam champion, Ivan Lendl, former world number one for 270 weeks. One of the greats in our game. So, Ivan, I'm going to start with you. You're the oldest in the panel today. Welcome to the show.
Thank you for that.
How is everything going with you during these tumultuous times in America?
Well, everything is going good. You know, everybody adjusts as they have to, and we just move on.
Very true. Alex, Spain, you guys have been going through tough times with the pandemic and the corona virus. What's the situation there where you are?
Well, similar as Ivan just said, first of all, thank you for having me here with the two of you. It's a big pleasure for me, guys. And of course, Spain has been struggling big time, but little by little, it looked like we adjust a little bit and we understand a little bit more how do we need to proceed if we need to know about how to proceed, because I think nobody knows in these days.
Very difficult times, of course. But somehow the tennis circuit is moving on. And can you believe it, guys? We are celebrating the 50th anniversary for the now called ATP Finals. Used to be called the Masters, the Volvo Grand Prix Masters, and Nabisco Masters. It's been all over the world. And of course, now it's in the last year in the O2 Arena in London. Ivan, you won this thing five times. You made nine finals in a row at the Madison Square Garden. What on earth did you eat during those weeks? How come that suited you so well?
It's just like the US Open, Mats. I ate home food. I was staying in Greenwich. I would go in the morning for practice in Madison Square Garden, go back home, have lunch, rest a little bit, and then drive for the match again. And I think home bed and home cooking is the key.
So you actually went home, if you had an evening match at the Masters, you would drive home to Connecticut and then come back in?
Correct, because if you go against the traffic, it was only about 35 minutes.
That's right. And you, of course, drove a very fast car in those days, I remember.
Car is not the issue, the speed limit is, huh?
Yeah, no, true. Yeah, I could never keep up with you. So, Alex, you won it in 1998. You beat your good friend Carlos Moya. This is your most successful tournament. Of course, you made the French Open final a couple of times, but for you playing indoors, what happened to you that week? That seems like it wouldn't suit you that well.
Well, I have to say, probably I won it because mentally I was very strong and physically as well. And as you know, you played that tournament at the end of the year. When I played that final, it was 29th of November. So the players are already kind of exhausted. And I have to say that year, the ball was bouncing quite high because they changed the surface. And it was like a green set, which it was not that fast. So I could adjust myself a little bit. I won Lyon a few weeks before, so I felt like I was sort of ready to play against the best players in the world. And yeah, maybe I was a little bit lucky because I saved a few match points against Sampras in the semifinals, and I was two sets to love down against Moya in the final. But somehow I managed to win it, and yes, I have to say it's my biggest tournament, yes.
I mean, unbelievable. You're going to get back to who you beat along the way. But Ivan, it's interesting when I look at your record, because you won two Masters titles before you won your first Grand Slam. But the opposition was tougher in the Masters because you would have to play five matches against the top eight in the world. What suited you about kind of knowing your schedule, knowing who you're going to play three or four days in advance, and then maybe the round robin format? Why was it so good to you, apart from sleeping at home?
I don't really know much, to tell you the truth. Also, keep in mind, we played on a very low bouncing, fairly quick surface. Yeah. And for some reason, I had a really good record on the surface, even though I didn't like it. I did not like Supreme Court, but I had a long match winning streak on Supreme Court, and I till today I do not know why.
I mean, I imagine that on your backhand, the ball wouldn't bounce up as high, so you could hit your backhand, and your forehand would skid through the court and would be impossible to return. So I can see why, Ivan.
Yes, but on the other hand, it was difficult to pass when somebody came in on a good backhand slice, because the ball was so low, and with one hand it was very difficult to lob as well, so they could close in on the net. So that's kind of confusing to me.
Yeah. Well, you played unbelievable. I played a couple of times. Alex, you beat Pete Sampras. Why is this the place where you beat Pete Sampras? Pete indoors, he won this thing 5 times as well. Talk us through how you thought you could beat Pete Sampras.
Well, I lost to him, as you remember, back in 96 at the US Open, 7-6.
We remember. Everyone remembers.
Yeah, everybody remembers. Yes, he was totally sick. But I have to tell you something. Everybody remembers because he won that match. Because if I would have won, they would say Correa beat Sampras because he was sick. So in a way, I prefer Sampras to beat me that match. So like this, at least they remember the match. Anyway, so I had the feeling that I could manage to beat him. And my only goal, it was try not to play short. Try to play as many times as I can to his backhand, and especially maybe not go too much for my first serve, more go for a big percentage of serves. And I remember I won 7-6 in the third that day. And my only thinking, it was like, okay, kick to his backhand and then try to go with your forehand, 3-4 to the backhand. And maybe if I have a room, go to the forehand. But if not, just keep on going to the backhand. He will play cross like this so I can play forever. So that was pretty much my tactics, I have to say.
Jeez, I wish I had tactics. Ivan, I have to ask you, now we're talking about Pete Sampras. You brought Pete Sampras once to the Madison Square Garden to practice. I remember you brought him and you were saying that, oh, he's the new up and coming. And I didn't really pay much attention. What did you, why did you bring Pete at that time? How did you know he's going to be so great? Because he wasn't great when he was 17, 18. He became great over a year, basically.
Well, Pete was training with me the week before the Masters at my house in Greenwich. We trained at my tennis club at Banksville. And I just thought it would be good for a youngster like that to be around big players and see how they do so he can learn. I remember when I was a kid and I could be around good players, I was looking at everything they do and how they prepare for the match and what they do after the match. Just trying to be a sponge and learn. And I thought it would be good for the young man. As far as the talent, you could see the raw talent. I thought he was going to win some majors. Obviously, I didn't have an idea that it's going to be 14.
Yeah, that's always a problem.
And Mats, what about, I mean, how come a guy like you that won several Grand Slams, like Rafa, let's say, but never won the Masters, and especially, I have to say, I have to bring this, got kicked by Ivan on, I think, 87, when you just made like 7 games in the final. And did you like the fact that you play with no tram lines? Because I did love it, but I'm not so sure about you.
So, Alex, thanks for bringing that up. Well, 1987, I lost to Ivan in the finals of the French Open. That was pretty close. I lost in the finals of the US Open. That was also pretty close, even though they were 4 sets. And I would have needed to win at least one of those to have feel like I had any chance. Playing Ivan again indoors for me was just the worst possible scenario. I know I never beat you indoors, Ivan. I hardly literally won games because I couldn't break serve. And somehow it didn't suit me to play Ivan because he was just way too good. The tram lines. We played a few years without doubles lines. And I thought the point, once the point was in play, it was okay. But to return serve, I could never figure out how much outside the singles line I was supposed to stand in the deuce court. Am I 1 meter away? Am I half a meter away? And with the doubles line, you could feel it. So I didn't like it at all. I mean, I really didn't. But that, no, I thought it was horrible. It looked good on TV, but... I tell you one thing about the New York situation when I played Ivan. There was a spectator at that time, and I think I was number 2 in the world, Ivan, because you clearly was number 1. And the spectator in the middle of the third set, he screamed out something like, "Hey, come on, Vilander, what are you ranked? 200? And I'm like, oh my God, just take me out of here. Get me out of here. So, yeah.
I can't believe you actually hear what people scream.
Well, after 6262, I'm hearing what people are. Yeah. I don't know if you ever got beaten that badly, Ivan, but that was a very horrible feeling.
I got beaten plenty times badly. And I usually was so angry I couldn't hear myself, never mind anybody else.
But what do you think? So let's talk. So I didn't win it. I didn't play very well there. I played great in 87, but just lost to a much better opponent. Rafa Nadal has not won it. Alex, why? I mean, we kind of know why the surface doesn't suit him and whatnot. But again, why can Rafa not win this?
Well, I think his game is not as effective as on other surfaces, of course. And I have to say also, from my point of view, when he gets to the Masters, usually is not the case this year. He's just nearly toast because we know that physically he spends a lot of time and making big effort. So I think mentally he's sort of like almost empty. And then the end of the year, the core is not bouncing as high as he wish. And at the same time, he already won probably Roland Garros. Many years he won US Open, other years Wimbledon or so. So I think it doesn't come as natural as maybe you guys, where you used to work indoors. For us Spanish guys, we work outside through the whole year. So for a Spanish guy going indoors, it needs to adjust his game. So I think that's why for Rafa, maybe it's a little bit difficult to win the Masters, which maybe this year it's a little bit different because in my opinion, it looks fresher, I guess.
Yeah. Talk to me about the round robin format, both of you guys. I know, Alex, you actually lost a match in the round robin format when the year you won. Ivan, I'm not sure that happened to you, but how does that change players' mindset? And I have to ask the question, do you think it has ever happened that a player would have thrown a match to get a better draw in the semifinals? Alex, you lost a match against Tim Henman and still won the tournament.
Yeah, well, I didn't throw any match, of course. It was just that Tim was better than me. And it was funny because my coach told me before the tournament, like, yeah, you got to believe you can do very good in this tournament. It was like, okay, indoors, it was not my best place to play. And when I lost to Henman, I went into the locker room. And as you know, we have our own locker room in the Masters. So I looked at him and I said, okay, yeah, I can do very well. I'm out of the tournament already. He said, like, no, wait, because if you win the next round, you know, next game, maybe with different results. So somehow I just went into the semis. I faced Pete and then Moya. So it gave me a second chance, which in a regular tournament, Ivan, that never happens.
Ivan.
Yeah, I agree. It's good and bad. Obviously, it's good for spectators that everybody gets three matches and they get to see their players. And it's bad that you can lose a match and still win the tournament. I'm not necessarily a fan of that. But it is what it is. It's the same thing as the tram lines, right? You like it or you don't like it, but it is what it is. You have to deal with it. You have to do the best you can with it.
Did you lose any match, Ivan? Or you all the tournaments you won, you just went all the way?
I can't remember because, once again, it's irrelevant.
He won many times that he doesn't remember.
No, but what I'm saying, Alex, it's irrelevant whether you lose a match or not. That's not what you remember. You remember whether you won the tournament or not. I remember one year I lost to Jacob Hlasek in 1988, actually. I was after shoulder surgery about a month before that, and I lost to Jacob Hlasek, and then I lost the first set 6-1 to Agassi, but I ended up beating Agassi, and then I ended up beating Tim Mayat, and I lost to Boris in the finals when we had that 7-5 in the fifth set tiebreaker, that long rally when like 37 shots or something, he hit the lead court, right?
That's the lead, yeah.
But as disappointed as I was that day, I was also very pleased because I knew I'm back after the shoulder surgery. As you guys know, when you get injured, especially if it's something serious, you need your confidence back. And it showed me that I was back.
That was one of the best matches or most intriguing matches that I've seen actually during my time as a player. What do you think of the five set scenario now that we bring up that? Because Ivan, the way I'm looking, every final you played was a 3 out of 5 set situation, and what the players can't deal with that today, or what, why is that not a rule?
I do not know why there is, it's not a rule, but I do know for a fact it's hurting the younger generation in the majors. Yes. I have a theory, Mats, that, and you tell me what you think after. I have a theory that it takes certain amount of, or certain number of 4 and 5 set matches, not 3 love or love 3, 4 or 5 set matches to learn how to deal with it. It's a new thing. It's very different than 2 out of 3. And we had Davis Cup, we had every finals, we had final ATP finals, and so on and so on. And you could get to, let's say, 20, 30, 4, 5 set matches in 2 to 3 years. Well, today the guys can't get there. And then all of a sudden, to me, it's a huge advantage for the older players to know how to deal with it against the young guys. Mm.
Couldn't agree more. Alex, what do you think of that? I agree 100% with that.
Yeah, definitely. As I said before, when I lost to Sampras, I lost 7-6 in the fifth. That gave me the experience to then know how to deal with such a tense situation, which usually when you play an hour and a half, you don't have this kind of feeling. And I agree with Ivan. I actually miss this kind of best of five finals. I know now they want tennis to be faster and to just play, you know, quicker and everything. But in my opinion, I mean, Masters final, the best tournament of the year for the ATP, it should be 100% a best of five. 100%. This is my opinion.
No, I think you're right. But let's move on a little bit and talk about Andy Murray. You both have interest in Andy Murray and both helped him along in his career. Of course, Andy Murray won it in 2016, became the world number one. I was actually in the stands, and Ivan, you were coaching Murray. How did that feel for you sitting there? I know that he won a couple of majors with you before then, but still, this is to be world number one at home. How nerve-wracking was that for you, Ivan, to work with Andy there?
It was not nerve-wracking at all. I felt very confident that Andy is going to win that match against Novak because he was playing well. And also keep in mind, he already was number one. It was who is going to finish the year number one.
Right.
So it's not all of it. It's still a bigger deal to finish the year number one than being number one during the year. But I felt Andy was playing well. He has lost one match since French Open. He lost to somebody, I think Nishikori maybe, at the US Open. Mm-hmm. Stan or Nishikori, I'm not sure. But he has won Queens, Wimbledon, Shanghai, everything he has played. And he was number one that way. And he was on a roll and played really well against Novak as well.
Yeah, no, I saw the match. It was unbelievable. Alex, I'm going to give you the word here because I believe you're the one that sort of cleaned the path for Ivan. He took all the success and he made, you know, Ivan made Andy Murray win grand. What did you do with Andy Murray, Alex, that helped Ivan become the super coach?
Well, I have to say, when I first met him, he was very young and I could say probably he was not as mature. Maybe he needed time, you know, to realize how, I mean, he knew he was good, but he had so many pieces of the puzzle like all over the place. So I think it was good for him to take them all together. So I think all the combination, it went that then, of course, Andy was very good. And with Ivan, they just found the perfect moment to realize that he can do it. And I was always amazed, Ivan, and I don't know if that was a tactic that you wanted to do with him or so when you were watching his matches. You didn't want to show him any passion or any nerves, or it was just the way you were acting with the people that you work with, or it was just specifically with Andy?
Well, no, I believe there was enough emotion in the box to start with. They didn't need any of mine. They were all jumping up and down at all times, right? But I think calmness was something which has helped Andy. Andy is very emotional and he can have ups and downs. And I think just somebody, and I believe same thing in tennis and golf, that you can't have big ups and big downs. You have to be somewhat level-headed to succeed. And it was not necessarily planned that way, but it was good for Andy, I believe, that somebody is there who just observes and is level-headed and doesn't get carried away with the emotions, because less emotions on the court, better you can play, in my opinion. Mm.
You know, I think I have to bring it up. I got in a little bit of trouble here during during the French Open with Andy Murray. He lost to Stan Wawrinka in the first round, and I was watching it and commentated on it for Eurosport. And I thought we saw an Andy Murray that wasn't that excited. He got beaten pretty easily. He wasn't excited. He wasn't angry. And I'm not sure, when you played tennis for such a long time, and Ivan, you were one of the first players to be physically, I think we were all fit, but you kind of took it to the next level, and you talked about it, and the nutrition was right. It was well documented how hard you worked. We all worked really hard as well on the tennis court, but not off the court. Andy Murray, he works this hard and he shows up at the French Open and he doesn't show emotion. How do you look at that as an older player? We still have to have the emotion to play our best tennis, or can you come out and change your mind and just be calm and level-headed and then still achieve what you want to achieve? How did this hit you, Ivan, when you got older? Maybe less emotion.
Well, I don't necessarily would call it emotion. I would call it passion. And I know you got criticized a lot for saying that Andy should not be taking wild cards and leave it to the young players. And I disagree. I think players like Andy Murray or Pete Sampras, before he won his last US Open, everybody was asking me, shouldn't Pete Sampras retire? And I said, Pete Sampras has earned the right to retire when he wants to retire.
Sure.
Okay. Yeah. And also, let's go a little bit back in the history of wild cards. The wild cards in general were given to the sponsors to get attractive players for their tournament. It kind of turned somewhat towards young players, which is fine as well, but it's nowhere written that it needs to be young player and not somebody older. To me, Andy Murray has earned the right to play when he wants to play, as long as he has passion for it. Sure. I'm not much in touch with Andy. We exchange texts here and there, and I do same thing with Jamie Delgado. And I do believe from little bits and pieces I have that Andy has the passion. What happened at the French, I think, was not normal. Something else happened, and I don't know what that was. But I think Andy has the passion. I think Andy is trying to prove that he can come back after serious hip surgery. And all I can say is we all should be pulling for him and wish him the best.
Oh, yeah. No, I'm pulling for him 100%. I'm with you, Ivan. He has deserved it. I think the interesting question is passion. Does Andy have the passion? And I think he does. I am 100% sure that he does. Oh, 100%. But are you supposed to show it every time you go on court? And that's the next question is, how does even Rafa Nadal, Roger Federer, I mean, 34, 35, 39 years old. I mean, I couldn't do it. Ivan, you didn't stay in the game that long. I don't know if it was a lack of passion or if it was a physical ability that prevented us from playing into. What is it, Alex, with Rafa that is so different? Rafa and Roger, and to a certain degree, Novak, what do they have that we did not have in terms of passion?
Well, I think they realize that they're playing for the history of the game even more than you guys, that for us, were when we were growing up, you know, Stefan, all these guys, Boris, we were thinking that you were like so big. They reach a level where they're fighting to become even better. And I think they're just fighting to each other to prove, even if they don't say that, who's going to be the best at the end of the day. And little by little, they're winning more and more. And the passion that they've got is huge. And also, they see that they're still better than the others, probably because they play best of five, which they got more room to win those matches. And they feel very comfortable, in my opinion, playing the slams, because at the end of the day, I don't think they have the feeling that they're going to lose with anyone on the tour besides top five or top three in the world. That gives them a big advantage. I don't know if you had that feeling when you were 32 or 33 years old, you know, that you are a little bit tired and you feel like, oh, it's difficult for me to win first or second round. It looks to me like first round or first week of the slams, they almost, with all the respects to everyone, get a little bit bored.
No, I think for me it was, and I'm interested to hear you, Ivan, but for me, the only time when I got to 30, 31, 32, the only time I really felt like I had a chance to do anything was at the Grand Slams. And even back then, because it was five sets and you felt, well, I know how to do this. It was tough though every day to try and get up and not to practice. That was easy, but to feel that passion that you need to make tactical decisions. Ivan, for you, if you had the opportunities and the facilities, the circumstances that players have today, would you have wished to keep playing till 36, 37, 39, even 40 years old? Or can you imagine yourself doing that?
Yes, I can. I absolutely loved playing. For me, it was my body. My body just gave up and I just couldn't do it anymore. But yeah. Also keep in mind, 34 those days was really old. 30 was really old. Yeah, These days, 33, 34, you're still there because they have better care, they have better nutrition, they have smarter training, they have learned a lot of things which we didn't know. So 35 is the new 30.
Very different, very different.
Actually, look, Ivan, he's about to come back. Look, his Versa climber he has behind him. He's like about to...
Isn't that Ivan?
It's my best friend and my worst enemy.
I've heard that there have been certain bets placed in and around a Versa climber, Ivan, that has involved you with certain people around Andy Murray's team. And give us a little more insight there, please, about the competitive nature of Ivan Lendl off the tennis court.
Well, it was interesting. We were, before Wimbledon, we went to LTA training center at Roehampton and they had a Versa climber there. So I got on it because I used to train on it and I wanted to see if my back is going to hold up for it. And it did, but I was not in that great of a shape. And Jess Green, who is, or who was at the time and this conditioning coach, was just making insulting, stupid, silly remarks to me. So it led to a bet that during the training camp in Key Biscayne in November or December, we're going to do 30 minutes on the Versa climber and the loser is going to have to read a statement written by the winner during Andy's press conference in Australia. And so I got myself a Versa climber. I trained 6 days a week and it wasn't much of a contest. And if you go on Jess Green Confession on YouTube, you will find that. And Jess did great job reading the statement. I was very kind. I could have been nastier to him, but Jess is a good guy.
That's too funny.
Ivan, the funniest part, Mats, is looking at Andy with his face down, trying not to laugh.
You could see that. You know, you could see that. I think that's what I think we all knew, Ivan. All the players that were around you and in the locker room. Realize that underneath yours and Andy Murray's, I think there must have been a lot of sense of humor that made the day sort of go by easier. And you got to have fun. And I know that you had fun too much sometimes and all the time. But there was a time,
Who is to judge if it's too much? Come on.
Exactly. But there was a time, Ivan, when we played the finals of the US Open in 87 and then in 88. And somewhere around those two finals, I was living in Manhattan in 87. I moved to Greenwich and I heard this joke. And they said, do you know if a Swedish tennis player and a Czech tennis player jumps from the top of the Empire State Building, who hits the ground first? And I said, don't know. And the guy said, well, nobody cares. Nobody cares.
There you go.
There you go. So what? How was that for you to not be the fan favorite? That's the wrong statement. But I think you didn't care about what the fans thought of you. Or did you care? Or did you use it in a way to fuel you? How did you look at that?
Look, you do care, but you have to do what you have to do. And if some people like it, then I don't care. Okay. Yeah. I have to train certain way. I have to put certain number of hours and so on in. And if that means I do 10 less interviews, so I do 10 less interviews. I also need time to rest. And that's what it is. But I think the key is you have to learn how to take energy from the crowd. So for example, if I play Davis Cup in Czech Republic, I wanted to win because I didn't want to let the crowd down. If I play Davis Cup in Argentina, I took the energy from the crowd because I wanted to piss them off. There's nothing better than that.
Absolutely.
Well, Mats, let me tell you that about the fan favorite or not. I have a poster. I had a poster on my room from this from this gentleman here, Ivan Lendl.
So you had no taste. Okay, good.
I do, because I loved your wristband like this big. Okay, I loved it. And then also from Stefan Edberg, Mats, I have to say, I picked the maybe different Swedish, maybe because of Adidas. And I have to tell you something, Ivan, you might not remember. I played against you in Bordeaux 92. And you
Yes, I remember.
Really?
Yeah. First set was 6-0, Alex.
No, man, 6-1, I think. 6-1, not still one game. 6-1. No, but listen, you just passed me with the forehand, and I was like, yes, I saw that on TV many times. So he did it to me as well. So I was proud that you did that.
But I'm glad you enjoyed it.
Yes. Unbelievable. Even if you beat me 1-4. But then I called my mom. So I said, Mom, could you just please remove the poster of the wall? Because I don't want to play this guy and think that he's my idol. So from that day on, I respected you so much, but you were not my idol anymore. At least that I was thinking.
The question, Alex, I have, did you make it a dartboard or did you just burn it?
Burn it completely.
Burn it, okay. We're good.
Yes.
Yeah, no, I can imagine. I had a poster of Guillermo Vilas when I played him in the finals of the French Open 82, but I kept it up. So, Ivan, I remember I actually talked to you a little bit when Sasha Zverev won the ATP finals in 2018. Of course, Stefano Tsitsipas won it last year. And you said something to me about playing smart tennis. And you said it's going to take Sasha Zverev a year and a half. And you said something that has stayed with me. These guys are hitting the ball so freaking hard that it's difficult to play really smart tennis all the time. And it's hard from the outside to realize how hard they hit the ball now compared to how we hit it back then. So what is this younger generation, Ivan? What is that, what they're doing that could maybe compete with Rafa, Roger, and Novak? Not at this moment, but in 4 or 5 years, are they going to hit the ball harder, the top, than they are today?
I think they are, Mats. And going back a little bit in our conversation today, when Alex was talking about Rafa and the Masters and indoors. On Saturday, I watched a little bit of Zverev against Rafa from Paris. And you can see in that match how difficult it is for Rafa. He can't run around his backhand. He hit more backhands than he ever does in a match. He does not have the serve plus forehand that often because the ball comes back faster. Then when it goes to his forehand, it goes fast, flat, and he cannot control the points. And you can see why it's causing Rafa such problems. On the other hand, the second thing I took from that match is I understand why it's Zverev's best surface. Sort of medium fast indoors, just like was in Paris, just like was in London 2 years ago when he won. It comes into his forehand nicely, so he doesn't have the high ball and low ball. There is no wind, and he can serve much better. His percentages of first serves are higher because of no wind. And also everything comes into his striking zone. That's why he's so much better on that than outside.
Right. Yeah, no, that's for
but
sure.
Yes, the guys 5 years from now will be hitting the ball harder. And I remember 1 year, probably 1983, I was having trouble beating McEnroe. So I sat at home and watched some tapes from 1982 when I was beating him. And after 10 minutes, I said, these two guys today are so much better than the guys a year ago. There's no point watching these tapes. So 5 years is a long time. There will be no Roger, no Rafa, no Novak, most likely in 5 years. So these guys will take over. And it will be interesting to see what, who and how it's going to play out. Is it going to be only power without any finesse, or is the guy who has somewhat of a finesse where he can hit a drop shot, where he can come to the net, where he can hit a good backhand offensive slice, who is going to be winning? It's yet to be determined.
Right, right. Alex, how do you see that? Stefanos Tsitsipas plays exactly like Ivan is talking about. He can chip a backhand, he comes to the net, hits the ball really hard. Where do you see these guys? What does their tennis look like in 2-3 years when one of these guys is the number one in the world?
Well, what it gives me a little bit of hope is that they play on such a big course, especially on the slams, that even if they play very fast and hard, they've got still some room to try to defend and play with the different heights, which I think it might help a little bit the difference of tactics. When they play in a smaller court, it's way more difficult to play, and it comes everything so fast. So in my opinion, power, it would be very important, but whoever is more consistent will still manage to win more matches. Because
smaller court, Alex, smaller court. You have to explain that to me and to the listeners, please.
Yes, sorry. Well, when we talk about smaller court, I know that the lines are the same. But when you play on court 12 of Australian Open and US Open or so, the distance between the baseline and the back fans is just 3-4 meters maybe, while in the big stadiums it's like maybe 8 or 9 meters. So you can see Thiem or Rafa, whoever returning so far back, or even Medvedev. So maybe in the future they will play closer to the baseline because they're doing more and more, but still they've got some more time to defend from very strong shots from the opponents. So what I said is like consistency, it will still be very important to become a very good player, even if they hit very hard, I believe. Mm.
You see, Mats, what Alex is saying is absolutely right. The courts now have roofs, which yeah. I understand why they have roofs, and I'm kind of resigned to the fact that's the way the game is going. But Australian Open with the roof on plays like an indoor court.
Yeah.
Wimbledon is different, but US Open, even with the roof open, the roof overhangs so much that the outside elements are not much in play. Most of the day that court is in shade now, as it didn't used to be, and so on and so on. But also to how these guys play the game, if you go back to this year's French Open finals, there were a few interesting things Rafa has done, which he has not done against Novak in the past. The one which stands out the most, he was slicing a short backhand down the line to Novak's backhand. Yeah. What did that do? That brought Novak forward, where he either had to hit the shot and back up, or he had to hit the shot and come in, where Rafa is standing in the backhand corner, and you hit it there, you're toast because he's standing. You hit it to his forehand on the run, you're toast as well. So yeah. Novak was choosing most of the time to either hit a drop shot or back up. These young guys can't do that. I have not seen a young player use a strategy like this. And we all talk about their movement. Zverev is 6'6", incredible mover, side to side. Okay? Tsitsipas, same thing. All these young guys, they move well side to side. The guy who is the best in the game moving north-south instead of side to side, but back and forth, is Roger. Okay? Arguably one of the greatest players in the game. And I think Medvedev is quite good at it as well, where he is way back, but as soon as he hits a good shot, he moves closer to the baseline so he can take advantage of a weak reply. And that's what's missing in a lot of guys' repertoire. And I think the player at this point who is going to do it the best may be the favorite to be the best of them all. Mm.
Because consistently the tactics is more aggressive, and in the long run, that's that has to help you. And I agree with you. Daniil Medvedev, of course, won the Paris Masters at Bercy, beating Sasha Zverev in 3 sets, and he did exactly that. So,
and guys, Max, you do have the technology at Eurosport. You can look at striking point for Zverev in the semifinals against Rafa, where he played closer to the baseline than I have ever seen him play. And then against Medvedev, he backed up again. Not as far back as some other times, but he was still noticeably further back than in the semifinals.
I think it helps him to have David Ferrer in his corner, especially when he plays against Rafa.
David is a great guy, and I'm sure he remembers how to play a lot of these guys, so it helps him, yes.
Yeah. No, it's going to be a great ATP Finals. Thank you very much. Alex, I'm going to give you the last word to have a chance to ask Ivan something that you have been wondering about that poster thing. I don't know how you would have Ivan on your wall. I mean, are you crazy?
Now, if you will have, because I'm sure that you've been having so many choices and options to work with players, if some player would call you now, which one would you like to say, this guy or girl, I will help?
I don't know, Alex. It's very, very difficult because it's one thing sitting in your house in Vero Beach, Florida, and think about that. But as I always say, when somebody contacts me and they're interested, not only do they interview me, I interview them. Mm-hmm. And it has to be a good match. For example, when you were leaving Andy, I got a call from Darren Cahill and said, would you meet with us? We're looking for a coach for Andy. We would like to tap your ideas. I said, sure. So we met and we talked for 3-4 hours about different people who coach and so on and so on. And, you know, I went home, didn't think much of it. I get a call a week later and the call is, would you be interested in the job? I said, well, that's totally different. We need to meet again because I have a lot of questions. So I think it's very important that you have to hit it off on human level. You have to hit it off in how you think that player should play. If you think you should stay back and I think you should come in, we're never going to do well together. Because one of us will have to compromise our beliefs. And we're all stubborn individuals. That's how we got where we are or where we were. And by compromising, it's not going to work because our heart is not going to be in it 100%. Mm-hmm. And so I think it's very, very important to kind of agree on things before you even start working. So I'm not trying to avoid your questions. There are many young players who are talented, but I can't really answer your question.
So I gotta insert before I let you go. Then I gotta insert there. Is that why the parent as a coach is working so well? Because there's not gonna be a compromise there because the parents know their son or daughter very well. And is that why it's so successful? Because it does seem like it's pretty successful. Of course, there's a lot of situations when parents are coaching that we don't see that are disasters. But in the top of the men's game, there's quite a few now that have been successful. What do you think, Ivan, about that parent coaching situation?
Well, I think parents deserve incredible amount of credit to get the kids where they are. Yep. Let's start with that. I also believe very strongly that there comes time and point or point in time where the parents should step aside. And I was with Andy and his mom, Judy, did not want to have anything to do with it. I invited her to lunches with us. I invited her to come to practices. And she says, no, you're the guy. He's in good hands. I don't need to be there. Okay. But if you talk to Alex from a few years earlier, it was a little different. And, you know, everybody has different thresholds. When the parents kind of step away. You can look at Tiger Woods. Tiger Woods came out of college and his father was a huge influence, but all of a sudden there is Butch Harmon, there is IMG, there is an agent and so on and so on. And Tiger became more independent. I do not know, was it because his father realized he should be with somebody who can offer him more because he already gave him everything he can? Is it because Tiger had enough and said that this? Is it the IMG or the agent who convinced senior to be less active and so on and so on? But at some point, I think it comes to that, where the kids move away from home.
Yeah,
basically, right? You move away from home and you take over your own life and you make your own decisions. That point is there. So once that point happens, then they need help from somewhere else.
Yeah, absolutely. Couldn't agree more. Well, it's going to be an interesting ATP Finals because obviously it's Stefanos Tsitsipas defending and there's so many great players. And we still have Rafa and Novak Djokovic in it. So guys, thank you very much. Ivan, always a pleasure. Thanks so much. I will now have a few sleepless nights after the 1987 finals in Madison Garden was brought up by Alex. Thank you, Alex.
Well, let me say something about that, Mats. You texted me earlier that you want to talk about that. So I'm pretty sure it was a setup through Alex to talk about it, right? I have to say this. 1987 may have been my best year on the tour. And that match we played at Madison Square Garden may have been one of the best matches I played. People and coaches and psychologists talk about getting into the zone. How do you get into the zone? I do not know till today. There is a thing called subzone, and you can learn how to get, or I did learn how to get into the subzone more frequently and so on and so on. Into the zone, I just fell into it in that match, maybe one of five matches or so, where I fell into the zone. And I felt like I can do nothing wrong that day. And I felt I was floating around the court and could hit any shot I wanted to. I tell you what, and I don't mean to rub it in or anything like that. No. It was one of the greatest feelings when you play number two player in the world and you win and you're in the zone in a big match like this. Sure. And you just play and it just flows and you don't remember anything from the match.
No, I thank you very much for trying to make me feel better.
I wasn't trying to do that.
Oh, you didn't? Well, it was my last Masters. I quit playing. I could have made it in 88 and I decided not to. So, no, thank you. So, thank you for that. No, you were in the zone. Guys, thank you so much. I hope you guys have a good holiday season that's coming up. Of course, first, we have the ATP Finals in the O2 Arena. I'm sure you guys will be watching. Alex, great to see you. Ivan, great to see you. Hopefully, we'll see you very soon again. Thanks, everyone, for listening to yet another Legends podcast on Eurosport.